Later, he visited the town of Tilo in the province of Siirt and withdrew into a famous tomb. There, in extraordinary fashion, he memorized the Ottoman dictionary up to letter S, seen in the Arabic script. When asked why he was memorizing the dictionary, he answered by saying, "The dictionary explains the different meanings of a single word. I have been interested to prepare a thesaurus showing how many words can be used for single meaning." His younger brother, Molla Mehmet, would bring his food to the tomb he had retreated by giving the little pieces in his soup to the ants around the tomb. He would be content with eating his bread by just dipping it into the soup. When he was asked, "Why do you give the little pieces to the ants?" his reply was, "I have seen these ants possess a sense of social life, and they act with endeavor and show great effort. In return for their passion for acting as a republican, I wanted to extend my assistance to them." Note: during the trial in the Eskişehir Criminal Court, he was asked the following question: "What are your thoughts on the system of republic?" "My biography will prove that, other than the chairman of this Eskişehir court, before any of you were even born, I was a religious republican." After retelling the story with the ants mentioned earlier, he went on to say, "Each of the rightly guided caliphs were both caliph and presidents of the republic. Abu Bakr the Veracious, may God be pleased with him, was most definitely in position of president of both the Ten Promised with Paradise and the Companions of the Prophet. But it was not a meaningless title and distinction. They were rather the presidents of the republic carrying the truth of justice and freedom of the Sharia in its religious meaning." While in Tilo, he saw Sheikh Abdul Qadir Geylani, may God be pleased with him, in his dreams. Addressing him, Sheikh Geylani, may God be pleased with him, said, "Molla Said, you will go to the chief of the Miran tribe, Mustafa Pasha, and invite him to the path of salvation. Advise him to stop his tyranny, begin his salat, and follow religious commands. Otherwise, you will kill him." As soon as he woke up from the dream, Molla Said started making preparations for his journey from Tilo to the Miran tribe. Upon arriving, he walked straight into the tent of Mustafa Pasha. When he was told that the Pasha had not yet arrived, he rested. The Pasha soon entered the tent. While all present stood up in attention, Molla Said did not even move an inch. He got the Pasha's attention. The Pasha demanded one of his tribal leaders, Fettah Bey, to tell him the identity of this person. Fettah Bey explained that this was the famous Molla Said. The Pasha, already never fond of scholars, was fuming and had not yet openly expressed his feelings. He asked Molla Said why he was here. Molla Said, "I have come here to put you on the right path. You will either stop your tyranny and start your prayers, or I will kill you." Being extremely angered, the Pasha dashed out the tent. After a bit of respite, he entered into the tent and asked Molla Said once more why he had come. Molla Said, "Like I told you, that is why I am here." Pointing to Said's sword, which was hung on the pillar of the tent, Mustafa Pasha exclaimed, "With what this dirty sword?" "Bediüzzaman, it is not the sword that cuts, it is the hand." Mustafa Pasha once again left the tent to compose himself. When he came back inside, he said to Bediüzzaman, "I have many scholars in Cizre. If you are able to defeat all of them in debate, I will do as you tell me to. But if you are defeated, I will throw you to the Euphrates River. Molla Said, just as it is beyond me to defeat all scholars, throwing me into the river is also beyond you. You will give me something after I have finished answering your scholars. Your Mavzer rifle. If you do not keep your word, I will kill you with it. Following this exchange, they headed off to Cizre on horseback together with the Pasha. On the way, the Pasha did not speak a word with Molla Said. When they arrived at the location of Bani Hana, Molla Said fell asleep out of tiredness. As soon as he woke up, he was surprised to find all of the scholars of Cizre sitting around him with books in their hands. After speaking for a while, tea was served. The scholars of Cizre were already familiar with the fame of Molla Said. In admiration and astonishment, they were waiting for Molla Said to start asking his questions. Molla Said, on the other hand, after drinking his own tea, had started drinking from the cups of the scholars next to him. They were so absorbed in thought that they never picked up on it. Mustafa Pasha addressed the scholars saying, "I am not a learned person, but I can already see from now that you will be defeated by Molla Said in debate. While you were all absorbed in thought and had forgotten to drink your teas, Molla Said drank his own cup as well as another two or three of your cups." After some light conversation with the scholars, Molla Said said to them, "Efendis, I have made a promise to never ask questions to anyone. I am ready to take your questions." The scholars asked him around 40 questions. After answering all of them, it so happened that the answer Molla Said gave to one of the questions was incorrect without the scholars being aware. After everyone left, Molla Said remembered this and ran behind them to say, "Forgive me, you did not realize, but one of my answers was not correct," and he gave them the correct answer. The scholars said, "It is now that you have completely defeated us." Some of those scholars later come to receive lessons from Molla Said. As he had promised, Mustafa Pasha gave his Mavzer rifle and began performing his salat. Molla Said's physical strength and agility was not short of his exceptional ability and amazing knowledge. He enjoyed wrestling and would spar with the students at the madrasa. He was also undefeated in wrestling. One day, he and Mustafa Pasha went out to race their horses. Little did Said know that Mustafa Pasha had ordered to have for him a lazy and untrained horse, which had never before been ridden. Molla Said mounted the horse. Allah knows best, but it is likely that the aim was to cause Said to fall and die. After walking the lazy horse around, Molla Said, who was then 16 years old, wanted to have the horse gallop and take it for a run. Suddenly, the horse went off track, running in a completely random direction. Although ordering it to stop, the horse continued to gallop frantically. With a dash, the horse entered an area frequented by children. A child of a respected landlord, Aa of Cezire, found himself in path of the raging horse. The horse stood up on its hind legs, and with its front legs hit the shoulders of the boy, throwing him violently to the ground and leaving the boy's body motionless on the ground. People from around the area came to help the injured boy. When they realized what had happened, they immediately wanted to attack Molla Said for retribution. The servants of the Aga drew their daggers out at Molla Said, who at the same time pulled out his rifle and said to the man, "In reality, the one who took away the life of the child is Allah. As for the cause, it is the horse. As for the reason, it is Bat Mustafa Pasha, since it is he who gave me this horse. Look, allow me to see the boy. If he has died, we can battle it out afterwards." Molla Said picked up the child and held him in his arms. Seeing the child was motionless, he dipped him into cold water. The child opened his eyes, smiling. Everyone was astounded. Following this incident, he stayed in Jizre for a while and decided to visit Biro, the place of the Bedouin Arabs, together with his student Molla Salih. There, Molla Said heard that Mustafa Pasha was going back to his old ways as a tyrant. He set off to confront him by advising and threatening him. During a heated conversation with Mustafa Pasha, Molla Said threatened him by saying, "Are you still being a tyrant? I am going to end up killing you for the sake of Allah." The Pasha's assistant came in between them. Molla Said spoke scornfully to Mustafa Pasha, who by now could no longer bear the brunt of his words. He attacked Molla Said to kill him. The Aas of the Miran tribe, however, got in the way. Eventually, Abdul Karim, the son of Mustafa Pasha, approached Molla Said and said, "He does not have correct beliefs. I request that you leave us for now." Molla Said did not turn Abdul Karim down. He walked away by himself and headed towards the Biro desert, where the Bedouins lived. On his way, he encountered Bedouin thieves. Molla Said shot his rifle in the air to scatter them. Having only spears as weapons, the Bedouins fled. On his journey, a second group of thieves crossed his path. This time, he was outnumbered. They surrounded him, and just as they were about to kill him, one of the thieves noticed Molla Said. "I have seen this man in the Miran tribe. He is well known," he said. The Bedouins immediately withdrew and asked Molla Said that he forgive them. They offered to guard him through the risky areas of the journey. Molla Said turned down their offer and continued on his way alone. After a few days, he arrived to Mardin. The scholars of Mardin unsuccessfully challenged him to a debate and agreed to accept this boy, who possessed such an advanced level of scholarship and was as young as some of their own children, as their teacher. Molla Said later came across two students who were visitors in Mardin. One of these students was a follower of Cemalettin Afgani, and the other was a follower of the Sanusi Tariqa. Through these students, he became acquainted with the method of Cemalettin Afgani and the Sanusi Tariqa. At a young age, Molla Said had entered into political life and began serving the country and nation. His first encounter with political life was in Mardin. Due to his involvement, the heavy-handed governor exiled him to Bitlis with his hands tied and with a police escort. At some point in the journey, it was time for Salat, and Said reminded the police to undo his handcuffs so he could pray. When the police refused, he opened the handcuffs swiftly and threw them on the ground. Shocked at what they had just witnessed, the police considered this to be a karamat, wonder-working, and said by way of submission, "Until now, we were your guards. From now on, we are your servants." Note: one day, it was asked of Bediüzzaman, "How did you unlock the handcuffs?" He said, "I do not know either. It could only be the keramet of Salat." When he was in Bitlis, somebody informed him that the governor and some officials were drinking alcohol. Angered at the news, he said, "I cannot accept that in a religious province like Bitlis, people who are representing the government are behaving this way." He went to see them and walked in on them as they were gathered in the act. Said first narrated a hadith about the prohibition of alcohol and continued with some bitter words. And persuading the governor to order his men to shoot him, Said kept one of his hands near his revolver. However, being an extremely patient and enduring man, the governor responded favorably towards him and did not speak a word. After Said left, the governor's assistant ran behind him and anxiously said, "What did you do? Your words will lead to your execution." The young Said replied, "I did not really consider an execution. I thought the punishment would be imprisonment or exile. Anyhow, what harm can come if I am killed for trying to stop a sinful act?" 2 hours after the incident, 2 police officers summoned Bediüzzaman in order to take him to the governor. As they entered the governor's room, the governor greeted the young Said with honor and respect. Wanting to kiss his hand, he said, "Everyone has an ustad, teacher, and you are my ustad." The young Said's nature could never bear living under oppressive laws or have his actions restricted in any way. He sought freedom in his actions at all times and would always say, "I would never allow arbitrary laws to limit my freedom." It was due to this that, when in Istanbul, he refused to have any restrictions imposed on his actions. This was a feature that was to stand out in every facet of Bediüzzaman's life. And it was the same love of freedom and being unrestricted which resulted in his defending the assaults of atheism and misguidance which originated from Europe during the second half of his life. He never gave into the principles of absolute despotism arising from natural philosophy and which is contrary to the Quran. Without ever submitting to such laws, he worked for the legitimate freedom and civilization enjoined by Islam. When he arrived to Bitlis, Molla Said was about 15 or 16 years of age and had just reached puberty. His knowledge until this time was in the form of meanings inspired to his heart, and he had never felt the need to go into arduous study. However, whether it was because he had reached puberty or due to his involvement in political life, the state of being inspired with meanings in his heart was beginning to disappear. As a result, he began to investigate and study books from all sorts of sciences, focusing on refuting the doubts leveled against Islam. Over a 2-year period, he memorized 40 books relating to Ulum-ı Aliye, Sarf and Nahiv, Grammar and Syntax, Logic and Ulum-ı Aliye, Tafsir and Ilmul Kelam. In fact, by reading each day, he would repeat all the books he had memorized once every 3 months. At this point, Molla Said had 2 conflicting states. The first, at times when his mind was expanded, he was able to master whichever book he picked up. The second, when his mind was constricted, let alone study, he did not even enjoy speaking. Molla Said began memorizing the Quran by reading 1 or 2 juz every day. By memorizing 2 juz every day, he memorized a significant portion of the Quran. However, he did not complete the memorization due to the following 2 reasons imparted to his heart. One was that He did not want to be disrespectful towards it by reading the Quran in a speedy manner. The other was that his heart was impelled to prioritize and concentrate on the truths of the Quran. And that was the reason why he ended up memorizing the 40 books relating to Islamic wisdom and sciences, which were to be the keys of the Quran and with which a defense and response could be made against any doubts. And by repeating a part of what he had memorized each day, he would read from memory all of the 40 books every 3 months. He started memorizing a book called Mirkat without its annotation and commentaries. He subsequently compared his perspective on the book with that of the annotation and commentaries in the book and found that, other than 3 points, all were in agreement. This aspect of Bediüzzaman also won the applause and appreciation of scholars. One day, somebody told him the lie that the esteemed Sheikh Mehmet Kührevi had performed a malediction on him. So he went to visit the Sheikh. The Sheikh complimented him and gave him a lesson for the time he remained there. This was to be the final lesson Molla Said would receive. One night, Molla Said saw the esteemed Sheikh Mehmet Kührevi in a dream. The Sheikh said to him, "Molla Said, come and visit me, I am leaving." Molla Said immediately leaves to see him, only to find that the Sheikh had already flown away. Waking up from this dream, Molla Said saw that the time was 7 in the evening and continued his rest. In the morning, however, he overheard the cries of mourning coming from the Sheikh's house. Visiting his house, he realized that the Sheikh had passed away at 7 in the evening. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un wa rahmatullahi alayh. Amin. In sorrow, he returned back. Receiving definite lessons of knowledge and science from such great and elevated scholars and sheikhs such as Sayyid Nur Mehmet, Sheikh Abdurrahman Taghi, Sheikh Fehim, and Sheikh Mehmet Kührevi, he had an overwhelming affection towards all of them. He also had a strong liking for Sheikh Emin Efendi, Molla Fethullah, and Sheikh Fethullah Efendi from among the scholars. There being no learned scholars in one, Molla Said left for one after an invitation by Hasan Pasha. He was to spend the next 15 years in one, traveling amongst the tribes of the province and delivering advice and giving lessons. During this time, he maintained good relations with the governor and officials. He realized that the traditional style of the science of Kalam was not sufficient to refute the doubts and misgivings on Islam in the century, and thus came to appreciate the need to study modern sciences. Note: this awareness Bediüzzaman had at such a young age was to set the scene and prepare him for the great service of Quran and Islam he was to perform in the future. 30 years after he expressed this conviction, Almighty Allah had granted him the success to compose the Risale-i Nur collection, which brought a renewal in the field of Ilmul Kalam. After having this realization, he began studying all the sciences that were broadly labeled as modern science. In a very short time, he studied the foundations of science such as history, geography, mathematics, geology, physics, chemistry, astronomy, and philosophy. He truly studied these sciences without a formal teacher through his own efforts. One time, he prepared for a debate with a geography teacher, whereby he memorized a book on geography 24 hours before their meeting. The next day, he defeated the teacher in debate, which was held at the residence of the governor of one, Tahir Pasha. In another incident, he would memorize and master within 5 days the science of inorganic chemistry and won the debate he entered against a chemistry teacher. The people of knowledge who witnessed the wonders of his abilities and the depth of his knowledge had given Molla Said the title of Bediüzzaman. During his time in Van, through all the ideas and studies he had undergone until now, and through his experience of the methods and views of schooling and religious education, considering the essential needs of the present time, he developed a unique method of learning. This method was to illuminate his students with the understanding of the age by employing the latest methods of explanation and articulation of the proofs of the truths of religion. While in one, some of the personal principles of Molla Said did not comply with the practices of the scholars of that region. Note, he followed the same principles in the whole of his 8-year life. These were as follows. 1. To never accept payments as gifts and even reject salaries offered by anyone. Indeed, the fact that he never even had a property to his name and lived a life of distress and terrifying disasters in poverty, isolation, constant exile and imprisonment, and yet never accepted anyone's money or gifts without giving something in return has been witnessed by all. 2. To never ask questions from any scholar. For 20 years he always gave answers to questions that were asked of him. His comment on this matter was, "I will never question the knowledge of the scholars. Thus, it is not befitting for me to ask them questions. Anyone questioning my knowledge can challenge me and test me, so I may answer them." 3. He would also prohibit his students from accepting zakat and gifts, just like he practiced himself. He would also teach them to work only for the sake of pleasing Allah. In fact, most of the time he would support the livelihood of students himself. 4. To remain unmarried and have no connection with anything in the world. Due to this, he would say, "I should be able to carry my possessions in my hand wherever I go." When asked why he was like this, he would say, "A time will come in which this practice of mine will be looked upon with envy. Secondly, possessions and wealth do not give me pleasure. I see this world as a guest house." During his time in Van, the late Tahir Pasha would read European books and prepare questions to ask him. Having never before seen any of these books, and despite his learning to speak the Turkish language in recent times, he would answer without hesitation. One day he came across these books and realized that this was where Tahir Pasha was preparing his questions, and within a short period of time, he mastered the contents of the books in this library.